G'day guys, I hope that you're having a good day. I just want to put a video out there because I keep seeing this idea that Russia is not making any ground and that the front line in and around Bakhmut, Soledar region in Ukraine isn't moving and is stable. And that, to me, is just not a fact. Looking at the map and this deep state map, this is a Western-backed map. You can see that, you know, they've got the Russians as pigs and, you know, that's it's a Western state map. So this is always going to be conservative towards the Russian gains and sort of pro-Ukrainian movements and update more slowly than Russia may move in some areas. And that's from my experience with these maps. And the Russian maps are the exact same. Of course, they're going to be more on the pro-Russian side. And if Ukraine makes an advance, it might take a while for it to update. But look, we're back here on the 31st, on New Year's Eve. And as you can see, we're zoomed in on the map here near Bakhmut, Soledar, and Kramatorsk, which is in the Donetsk Oblast and the start, really, of the Donbass. So if you watch, this is where we're zooming into, where my mouse is. And I don't buy, and a lot of other people don't buy as well, that this area, that Bakhmut, Soledar, isn't important. We're being told from sort of both sides that, oh, this isn't too important, we're just, you know, doing this and that. Well, why is the most fierce fighting here? If this wasn't important, both sides wouldn't be throwing hundreds to, if not thousands, of guys daily, it seems, into these areas to defend or to make an offensive on the opposing sides. So we're back here on New Year's Eve, and you'll start seeing over the next 10 days the advances of the Russian side and small advances taken then retaken by the Ukrainians. But we'll just roll through. So the first, we just see a little bit above Bakhmut. The second, not much happens. Third, small advance towards from Russia. Fourth, again. Fifth, we've got a major movement in up on the north of Soledar. You can see that's back to the fourth, and then the fifth, this is the ground that Russia has made. And then sixth, this is where that Russia first really entered Soledar, like right on the outskirts of where the small town, small city, or large town, small city of Soledar is. Seventh, they've moved well on the west side, west past Soledar on the southern side, and they've sort of started that envelope of surround. Eighth, you can see that put like that pincer pushing in on it, and the ninth of today of where we are, and that small gains day by day by day. And this is something that I don't know how you stop Russia doing this. Russia obviously prepared to just throw men at things and prepared to fight for a long time. They're just pushing that inch by inch daily, and that's something that I guess a lot of channels I've been watching on YouTube are sort of like, no, the front line's stable. Well, no, let's roll back through the last 10 days. We'll go a bit quicker. And this is the advance is being drawn back from Russia. And then if we go back a little bit further, you'll start seeing it draw back further and further and further. And yeah, day by day, there might not be much. We're back on the 18th of December 22 now. But if we roll forward to today, you just see this creep of the Russian advance slowly creeping forward through Bakhmut, Soledar, and to where we are today. And this is very important because if they cut off these supply routes that a lot of people are saying the front line further up to Seversk may end up collapsing from the supply. Now, I don't know if that will happen. I don't, like, in this, people who try and foreshadow this war, and oh, if this happens, the whole front line collapse, and we haven't seen that on both sides, except the really standout case was Ukraine's thunder runs in the Kharkiv Oblast, where they managed to take a massive amount of ground slowly. But those offensives have sort of not been seen recently by Ukraine, and Russia is taking some ground in here. I also want to mention, I actually lost a friend of mine and someone who was a very large supporter of the charity work I was doing in Bakhmut, an Australian soldier, maybe a week ago now. So it's reached all points of the globe, I guess, of the amount of casualties that both sides are having here and the intensity of the fighting. and the loss of life on both sides is just unbelievable. I'm seeing photos of both Russian and Ukrainian soldiers frozen to death. There's the very famous photograph of the Russians in a field that looks like something of a world war, just men in no man's land dead. It's unbelievable. Now, something else I want to touch on is overnight, and I pretty much saw this come through as I was in bed, and then this ruined my sleep because I was then like, oh, I've got to research this. Was it came through Russia Today and all the Russian Telegram channels of Moscow response was a criminal attack in the DPR. So when earlier on New Year's Eve, New Year's Day, Russia had an attack in Makiivka, Ukraine attacked Makiivka in the DPR, which by any maps other than Russian maps would say that that is in Ukrainian territory, of a barracks of Russian soldiers. And no one really knows exactly how many were killed, but it's almost certainly in the hundreds, which is unbelievable to bomb that barracks, kill hundreds of Russian soldiers in one go. So last night it came out, the bombardment on Sunday was a retaliation operation carried out in response to a criminal attack. It's a war. You can bomb each other's soldiers. By Ukraine on a temporary housing area accommodating Russian servicemen in the city of Makiivka in the Donetsk People's Republic on New Year's night, the ministry said in a statement. Over the past 24 hours, the Russian military has managed to uncover and confirm the location of Ukrainian troops in Kramatorsk, which is up in the west of where we were just talking about. In the DPR, the statement read, the data revealed that Dormitory 28, whatever, the city was hosting more than 700 Kiev soldiers with 600 staying in Dormitory 47. So you're talking 1,300 soldiers. And this was unbelievable. Well, I guess anything's believable in a war. You're like, wow, like, I can't believe this just happened. And I thought, I'll reach out to a very trusted friend of mine. And this was in minutes of it happening. And he basically said to me, according to Kramatorsk, there was an arrival at night. The vocational school building knocked out windows, frames, doors, beat communications, no 200. Near two residential nine-story buildings, windows were also knocked out in them. And that number 200, he confirmed with me, means code 200, meaning no casualties. Now, I'm sure people were probably injured in this. You know, missile lands and bloody glass and frag goes everywhere. But the numbers of 1,300 killed, well, the photographs speak for themselves. Now, this is just I can't believe they try and put propaganda with no backing. And I know both sides are very guilty of these massive sort of propaganda attacks that very quickly get turned over of like, well, that's just incorrect. But trying to claim that 1,300 men were killed and then the photographs show the windows blown out and 1,300 guys, you're going to have bodies, you're going to have those as absolute rubble. So it's one of those very, very difficult situations where it's just Russia completely lying. And it's not just Telegram or some random. It's Russia Today. Now, I know people say Russia Today is, you know, state media and it's untrusted, blah, blah, blah. But a lot of people do trust that. And a lot of people won't go further on and go from there. And lying at this level is very dangerous. And I don't know what Russia would achieve by this, because now people have just called them out as liars and it reaffirms that idea of propaganda and lying about things. And so I don't know. But look, I just thought I'd give this quick update on these regions, what's happening. I think in the next couple of weeks, if the tracking by this is anything, we will start seeing Russia take Soledar and maybe even take Bakhmut. And from there, I guess it's all up in the air of then what happens from there and where the continued Russian advance is, and as well as all the Russian equipment being moved into Belarus on a training exercise, which, well, how did this war start in the lead up to the 24th of February when it started? What was all the Russian equipment doing on the Ukrainian border and in the DPR? It was a training exercise. These vehicles are marked with a Z. Why would you have Z vehicles marked like that if you're only training? Helicopters, everything. A lot of people that I'm talking to and reached out to are saying that we will see a second attempt on the capital of Kiev or in the north of Ukraine, but we'll be unsure. I'm hoping to go back to Ukraine in the coming weeks. I just need to get some logistics stuff ready and some funding ready as well. That's why I've been home, and make some money, go back and do what I can, as well as some other places. But It may take a while. It might be more than that. But I fly to the US tomorrow. So if you're in Dallas, let me know. Catch up for a beer. But thank you very much. Look after yourselves and have a nice day and stay safe.